I'm Gert Hoffmann. I'm working for RedHat. Cleaning room most of the time, or also some other stuff now and then. And I'm maintaining most of the graphics stuff in QEMU. That includes both the graphics card emulation and also the display side of things, user interfaces we have in QEMU, as the GDPs file and so on. And I want to talk today about what happened. What happened in QEMU graphics last year? The big topic, of course, the WIRT IOGPU, where we made a lot of progress in the last year. We talked about the guest side of support, the host side of support, a bit how the OpenGL rendering works in QEMU, and finally also cover GPU assignment and virtual GPU. So let's start with GPU. There's always some confusion between those two devices we have. We have a WIRT-IO VGA, and we also have a WIRT-IO GPU PCI device. And it's basically very similar. WIRT-IO VGA is just the same as WIRT-IO GPI, but with with VGA compatibility added. The VGA compatibility part is pretty much identical to the standard VGA we have in QEMU. So if you turn on your virtual machine, it starts in VGA mode, and as soon as the guest driver loads and configures a display using a WIRT-IO command, it switches over to a WIRT-IO GPU mode and will display whatever it receives using WIRT-IO commands, and if you reset the device, it will switch back to VGA mode. So the VGA mode is useful for backward compatibility because we are on x86 hardware, and VGA has been there for ages, and pretty much everything knows how to talk to it. It's also quite useful for the frame buffer because it's easy to set up, and once you have set it up, it just works because you have the usual dirty tracking in place so you don't have to do anything on updates. In contrast, if you're in WIRT-IO GPU mode, you explicitly have to send WIRT-IO GPU. You have explicitly send commands to the device to get your display updated. The only thing, VGA mode is not working on ARM. For the usual cache currency issues, same problem why the standard VGA itself is not working on ARM, at least not on real ARM hardware. If you're running your ARM guest emulated with TCG on the x86 hardware, it works, but not on real ARM. So on ARM, you just can use the WIRT-IO GPU PCI device without VGA compatibility. And there's work in progress by Laszlo to actually create a driver for the OVMF firmware to be able to use this device for output. But you'll probably not get EFI frame buffer working on that. But it should work at least for the firmware display itself, and maybe also GRUB.
Of course.
Hmm?
It does work.
Yeah, that's the important thing. If you want to select a kernel, that you can do that. So this is our WIRT-IO VGA device has an MMIO bar, and this is how it's organized. There are three regions which are also present on the standard VGA device, which you can use to program it without using the
classic VGA ports, they are just mapped into that MMIO region. And there are also the VIT.io PCI regions. And on a VIT.io, GPU PCI device looks pretty much the same, except that the first three regions are not there. And also the PCI bar with the frame buffer itself isn't present on the VIT.io GPU PCI device. So where we are regarding guest support. We have the VIT.io GPU kernel driver, which is the usual kernel mode setting driver, where you can have your frame buffer console on which any graphics application, X-Server, Wayland, and so on can use. It was merged in the Linux kernel in version 4.2, supporting only 2D mode without 3D acceleration. So that's a nice baseline for all guests. 3D mode was added in kernel 4.4, and we recently got some bug fixes in for multi-head. Multi-head was in the design of the device right from the start, but wasn't tested much, and so if you really want to play with it, you should get the latest kernel, which has fixes in, so things actually work. So you also need the user space driver, which is in Mesa, was merged in version 11.1. There isn't a special Xorg driver needed anymore. Xorg driver can use Glamour for acceleration, which uses just uses the Mesa driver to accelerate graphics in Xorg. It's actually committed already. It's just a small commit which adds the PCI IDs for the VIT.io PCI devices, telling the X-Server it can use these devices with Glamour. It's in the master branch right now. There is no released version yet with the X-Server. But it's an easy patch. It's backported in Fedora, for example. And that's pretty much the only thing missing on the guest side, which is not yet available in some released form. So the big achievement from the last year is that at least the guest side is almost completely upstream. So if you're looking on the distributions, how support looks there, Fedora 24 supports it right from the start. It works even in Fedora 23, but you have to apply other updates because the release kernel of Fedora 23 is too old. There's an Android build, which is running here right now as a presentation, which has a Mesa-based OpenGL stack and has virtual support enabled. And all the other distros should pick up VIT.io GPU support with 3D acceleration as they update the packages, because everything is upstream meanwhile. And if you want to check your distribution, you can just grab for virtual in the kernel messages and in the GLX info output to see whenever your kernel is new enough to have virtual support and whenever it's properly enabled. And you can and GLX info to see whenever your Mesa is new enough and has support enabled. On the host side, VIT.io emulation support also was merged in two stages. First, the 2D mode only without acceleration that landed in QEMU 2.4, so it's available for quite some time already. 3D mode was added shortly thereafter in version 2.5, but it comes with some additional dependencies. It needs a virtual render library, which does pretty much all the hard work. I come to that in the moment, in the next slide. And you also need OpenGL support in the user interface, and this was also added in stages later on. Same with multi-head that went untested for quite a while, as mentioned already, and we also have on the host side some multi-head fixes which landed in 2.7, which is about to be released. So again, if you want to try multi-head with a Dio GPU, be sure to use the latest version. And also added in 2.4 is support for live migration in 2D mode. So that's one of the drawbacks if you want to use 3D acceleration, that you can't live migrate to a virtual machine. But right now, we only support local display on the same machine anyway, so you're trying to live migrate your machine anywhere else doesn't buy you much, because you wouldn't have any display. Virtual Renderer is the library which does actually the hard work. It was created by Dave Alley. And what it basically takes is a Gallium command stream. Gallium is a Mesa internal representation of the 3D commands translated from OpenGL into some intermediate language, and it will be translated from that to the actual hardware by the driver. And Virtual Render will take that command stream, which is sent over VirtIO from the VirtIO GPU device, and translate it to OpenGL to pass it on to the host CPU, so all the operations from the guest are executed on the host. It's a pretty complex thing, and it's also a security sensitive thing. And so we won't try to sandbox the whole thing for security reasons. Marc André is working on that, and it's trying to use VirtIO user to run the virtual renderer in a separate process, which you can easily sandbox. So in case there's some bug in virtual renderer which can be exploited, it would only affect the separate process and not QEMU itself, so the security impact of any bugs in virtual renderer is much smaller. So that's something we hopefully have next year. So as already mentioned, you also need in the user interface support for OpenGL. The first user interface supporting this was GDK in QEMU 2.5, together with the initial virtual support. And we actually have two different code paths for GDK, simply because of the reason that GDK got native OpenGL support in version 3.16. So we have one code path for the newer versions, which actually uses native support. And doing that is needed to correctly run on Wayland, because otherwise the page stripping doesn't work correctly. And we have another code path using EGL directly and open render nodes manually for the older GDK versions. SDL support landed in QEMU 2.6. Also a support for local display with SPICE. And getting a remote display is still in progress. I come to that in a moment. And one thing to keep in mind is that it's not yet playing nice with SA Linux, at least not on my machine running RHEL 7. Maybe it's fixed already in Fedora, I'm not sure. So if you have some trouble getting this running, you can try turning off SA Linux and see if that is a blocking thing. So I think the policies still need to be updated to allow QEMU to access the graphics card. So the most interesting thing for me is using SPICE. The big advantage of using SPICE compared to SDL or GDK is that you don't have a dependency on your display server. So you can keep the virtual machine running and disconnect and even restart your X server without your virtual machine dying. And how this works, that is SPICE uses render nodes recently added to the Linux kernel to do all the rendering operations and render into a texture. And then it can pass this texture, export it as DMA buff, and pass it on to the SPICE client. And the SPICE client then can import this DMA buff and display it. It depends on a pretty, not that new anymore, Mesa and libepoxy versions. And spy support is still a bit experimental. It's in a development release, merged upstream. So one thing I've tried to do is to use the new Flatpak thing to say, OK, I can try bundle my QEMU with this experimental spy server library. So I can run and test this without having to run an experimental spy server on my normal host machine. Which works nicely if you run QEMU directly, but it doesn't work that nicely if you try to run it with libvirt. And I think the problem is simply that both Flatpak creates a sandbox for the application it's running, and QEMU and libvirt is also creating a sandbox for QEMU to run it in for security reasons. And I simply think that Flatpak running inside the libvirt sandbox just doesn't work because it hasn't the permissions to create another sandbox inside. So, yeah, wasn't that successful. On the client side, you need a Spice GDK, which is recent enough. There's a 0.32 release, which is I recommend if you can use it. There's also support of this in 0.31. But and that was the last release which has support for GDK2. GDK2 support was dropped in newer Spice GDK versions, but I think it shouldn't be much of an issue these days anymore. So I should suggest to get the latest one. And also important is to have a Unix socket connection for Spice, because that's needed to pass on the DMA buffs from QEMU to the Spice client, because that uses Unix file descriptor passing. And the way to do this is use virt viewer with the attach flag, which will then ask libvirt to establish a Unix socket connection between virt viewer and QEMU. So a bit on detail on the DMA buff passing. As the library renders the guest display into a texture, then you can create an image from that, export it, get a file handle, which we can send over. And the Spice client can import it and bind into it in texture. And all this happens without having to actually copy the image data. We're basically just passing through a handle to that. So we avoid expensive copies of the display data. So this is a snippet from the libvirt config if you want to play with this. You have to say disable TCP, this one, because you need, as mentioned, you need the Unix socket connection. GL enable enables OpenGL support in Spice because it's turned off by default. And finally, you need the VO model, virt.io, and libvirt will just create everything. And if OpenGL support is available in the user interface, the virt.io GPU graphics card will also enable 3D support by default. So that's an outline of the process. The guest talks, in the guest runs a driver, talking to the device, sending the GL command stream or the Gallium command stream to the device, which is then processed by the renderer library. And then you have this texture, and that's the common thing for all user interfaces, that they're going to work on this texture. Spice server will export it as a DMA buff and pass it on to the client for display. And in case of the SDL2 or GDK display, QEMU can just talk directly to the display server to display the texture. We also have You also can do this for the normal VGA. In that case, we have a kernel mode setting driver, BossGVM, in recent kernels. In that case, you just get a normal display surface. It's a normal representation of a guest display in QEMU if you're not running with any 3D acceleration. And QEMU has some code to also copy this display surface into a texture. And then we can go on, use the same output path for in SPICE and SDL2 and GDK to actually show the guest display. And that way, we also avoid encoding a guest display as TCP stream and set it over SPICE or VNC. So that's basically a shared memory transport for the standard non-accelerated QEMU display devices. So the remote display is still a work in progress. And the idea is to encode the guest display's video and send that over to the client side. There are some very experimental patches already using the GStreamer support, which was merged in SPICE server recently. And of course, we also want to try to use the hardware encoding if it's available to reduce CPU consumption. That's a bit tricky because there are a number of different APIs. The SVA API, which was created by Intel and is supported by Intel, and supports encoding and decoding. The SVD POW, which was created by NVIDIA, it's also supported by AMD, I think. And I think there's even a wrapper, so you can use that API with a VA API driver. But it supports decoding only. That would help on the client side, of course, but not on the server side. And NVIDIA has a proprietary library, and a code and a proprietary library which you can use. So we have to sort that. And of course, there is also the usual pattern problem around those codecs. Meanwhile, we have the Cisco codec, which might help here if you're looking for a software fallback. And recent Intel hardware luckily also supports the open VP8 and VP9 codecs. So at least on Intel hardware, we can use that and don't have any trouble with the patents. Because it's always a problem that we can't easily chip the software. We have sorted that for this Cisco thing recently in Fedora. That's a nice thing. So now to physical hardware. You can use VFIO with a GPU. That isn't exactly a new thing. Alex already talked on that in the 2004 KVM forum. It's linked there. That's why it's blue. What we've added recently is support for Intel graphics, which is a bit tricky because it has dependence. It's a chipset graphics, and the way Intel designed it is has dependencies to some other devices of the Intel chipset. So the driver looks at the host bridge, the driver looks at the Ether bridge. So we added some quirks to handle that and was merged in Linux 4.6, QEMU 2.7. And we hope that this support will also be useful for virtual GPUs. Something recently added, which is useful if you assign a complete device to a guest, is input Linux. That's some code which can talk directly to Linux EFDEV devices, read mouse and keyboard events from there, and pass them on to the guest. And that simplifies the input side a lot if you're running VFIO and GPU assigned with VIO and a local display connected to it, so you can just use a normal keyboard and type and don't have to use any workarounds like adding an emulated graphic just to have an SDR window where you can move your mouse pointer to, so the so your keyboard input lands in the guest. So that simplifies the input side for that use case. This was merged in QEMU 2.6. Work in progress is also to work with virtual GPUs. We had an NVIDIA talk on that earlier today. The online version of the slides will have the link later on. I still have to figure out where they have the slides online. The virtual GPU works pretty much comparable to SREOV, but the separation is not handled by the hardware, but by the host driver instead. And because it's handled inside the kernel, it's pretty much transparent to user space. So the plan is to just use a well-established VFI user interface also for this case. So we can use QEMU device, VFI or PCI, and it will just work. And yes, this framework for that is in development. And for all the details, I happily refer to the talk by the Emil folks. Intel is also working on VGPU integration. They integrated directly into the DRM driver. The first bits of this support landed in the last merge window. And but that's just the support they need inside the graphics driver. So they can export the guest display to the host and so on. The KVM integration depends on the MDEV driver I mentioned in the previous slide. So this is a joint project which will be used by all VGPU implementations. And the plan for the guest display is that it will be exported as DMA buff, and we then can use that DMA buff again to show it on the screen. So in the guest, the normal driver, KMS, kernel mode setting driver runs. The host driver processes all the commands and handles things inside the kernel and exports the guest display as DMA buff for us. So we can just import this DMA buff, have in texture we can work with and display directly using the GDK or SDL user interface, or go the path to the SPI server. And we'll probably go refine this a little bit to teach the QEMU core about DMA buffs. So we can handle either an DMA buff or texture and we'll import, export stuff as needed. So we can skip this import and re-export step and pass on the DMA buff we got from the kernel driver directly to SPI server to have it display things. Another approach when it comes to show the guest display is that you can do the video encoding we are planning to add to SPI server, where the encoding happens on the host side, is to actually do it inside the guest. If you assign the complete GPU to the guest, the host has no control over it, so doing it inside the guest is pretty much the only option you have. It also works on bare metal. There exist commercial solutions for that, which is, for example, used by some game streaming things. And of course, you could also do the same with vGPU, that you do the guest encoding, have the guest do the video encoding. And the big advantage of that is that you have the very same setup on bare metal, on if you assign a complete GPU or if you assign a virtual GPU. There are also a few downsides, of course. It's not transparent to the guest. So you have to install software which does the video encoding and exporting it to some display application. And there's also no SPICE integration. although they could try think about that. An idea could be that you have a guest agent running inside your virtual machine which sends the H.264 stream to the host over virtual CL or some other means. And then we could try integrate that with Spice, that even though the guest encoding actually happens inside the guest, you still can use your normal Spice client to display the thing. So the question is whether it's worth trying this, because it only works for the VGB MOO case, of course, not if you're running on bare metal. So one of the advantages from doing it inside the guest, that it's the same setup, works everywhere, goes away if you're going the Spice route. And I think that's something we can either discuss after this talk, or there's also a buff about VFIO and VGPU, and I think it's also a topic we can discuss today, because I think that's tricky to get this right, or find a good solution for it. So, and I think that's it. Yes, the slides are online. Link is there. Yes.
On slide 6, can you please go back to slide 6? Yeah, what's Glamour? Can you define it shortly, please?
Glamour is a library which uses 3D acceleration, or uses OpenGL for the 2D acceleration of the X server. So all the X server operations, the classic 2D operations, accelerated using OpenGL, so you don't need a hardware specific driver, but you just can use the mesa driver.
Thank you. Next slide. It seems to suggest that Fedora 24 installer media has Virtio GPU drivers built in. Do you happen to know if that's the case for AR64 as well? I think AR64 is still a secondary architecture for Fedora, so maybe they have a different kernel config. I don't know.
It should be the case that there's no reason to not do it, but they have different configs for each architecture, so it could be they missed it.
All right. I'm pretty sure it's enabled already.
Right. I'll try it. Thank you. And slide 12, please. Around slide 12.
Too far. This one?
Yeah, it's about guest drivers, so around this neighborhood. I wanted to ask about any plans or, well, possibility for a Virtio Wind driver for Virtio GPU. Actually,
I'm not aware of anyone working on this, although people ask for it, so there clearly is an interest in having one. But I think, especially if you want to have 3D acceleration with it, which is an interesting thing, it's quite a chunk of work, as far as I know. So
because
I'm not expert on that. So,
I'm not actually insisting on Virtio Wind drivers for this. I just got a use case. Assume you have a like quite sort of modern laptop with a Fedora 24 operating system host, and you run Windows 7 or Windows 8 in a guest, and your kid goes to school, and they have some 3D assisted learning tool or whatever runs in Internet Explorer, ActiveX, whatever, and it wants 3D. So what from these many, you know, parallel stacks that you displayed, which one is, you know, the closest on the horizon for being usable for this, for such a use case? What would you recommend? If it's more appropriate for the BOF, we can discuss it there as well. So I don't want
to. Someone has to write a driver, and I have no idea how difficult it is, because you have basically to use Virtio GPU, you have to translate the Windows 3D commands into this Mesa Gallium command stream. I have no idea whenever maybe some work inside Mesa already exists for Windows support, which does some of this this might help to get it done.
Assuming the laptop itself has Intel integrated graphics, IGD pass-through could be you know, like a faster solution for this, maybe? I mean, faster, more available.
Sure. The big advantage of using pass-through is, or using vGPU, is that inside the guest, the normal drivers are running. There's Intel driver used inside the guest. And the guest driver, in the Intel vGPU case, the guest driver needs some adjustments to be aware of the vGPU thing. But this has been merged into the Linux kernel quite a while ago, and as far as I know, the Windows drivers shipped by Intel at the moment also know about this. So you can just install the normal drivers, and they should work with both pass-through and vGPU once this is available.
Thank you.
Actually, I have the same question about availability of this on Windows. So, but on my experience, the main problem for Windows drivers will be transformation from DirectoryD to OpenGL, which is possible but difficult.
Yeah, can imagine that.
Okay.
One thing I can show is so this is how the messages are looking. Here it says what kind of device it has found, whether it's VIO VGA or VIO GPU PCI. And the line just next to it says whether 3D acceleration is enabled or not. So that's the first thing to check if things are not working as expected inside the guest. And then some more informational output. No, I'm mouse pointer is yeah, should have it on the screen here. Okay. I have to restart the whole thing. That's tricky when looking from the side, yeah. So that's a small demo. Can't to control much here because usually it's done with the gravity sensor in your tablet, so you're going like this. I can try this with a laptop, but it wouldn't help. We don't have gravity sensor emulation in QEMU, and also the laptop. So. Yeah, you can just sit and watch what's going to happen. Okay, that's it.